Hachette Audio presents Narcotopia, in search of the Asian drug cartel that survived the CIA. Written and read by Patrick Winn. Dedicated to all the world's Highlanders. Author's note. Most accounts of the drug trade are told from the law enforcement perspective. There's a reason for this. Drug Enforcement Administration agents who describe their adventures to journalists are often lionized. They might even score a budget hike for their department. But drug traffickers have little incentive to tell their stories. In that profession, running your mouth leads to prison, or worse. The upshot is that most drug war stories sound the same. Valorous detectives battling vile figures, the junkie, the pusher, the kingpin. It is a genre of half-told tales. This book does not presume virtue among anti-narcotics agents or cruelty among traffickers, or vice versa. I've relied heavily on accounts of lawbreakers in the Golden Triangle, some of whom risked their necks to talk to me. Because few of these sources are scrupulous record keepers, I'm forced to lean on their memories. Every attempt has been made to corroborate their oral histories with other witnesses, but in some cases, I can only present recollections as they were told. Police records and anthropological studies of Wa rituals helped me reconstruct scenes. Central Intelligence Agency and DEA documents proved vital. Some are declassified, others acquired by creative means. For clarity's sake, I've sometimes rendered multiple conversations into one, or shifted the order in which certain facts were revealed to me. Most names in this book are genuine, but I've disguised several identities to prevent retribution, from either criminals or government agents. These are my caveats. They allow for perspectives seldom heard. Few of the stories in this book appear elsewhere. My goal is to present a narrative that is more expansive and truthful, less monochromatic. There is good and evil in this book, but it mostly resides in the heads of its characters, crusading for honor and power, and always believing themselves more righteous than their enemies. Finally, a note about the term Golden Triangle, which lacks a formal definition. I use it to describe Southeast Asia's drug-producing heartland, a mountainous area, almost entirely in Burma, that seeps across the borders of China, Laos, and Thailand. It is, to coin a phrase, a narcotopia, a place where narcotics are a defining force shaping commerce, politics, and daily life. This zone powers a regional heroin and meth economy that is, according to the United Nations, possibly worth more than the entire GDP of Burma itself. Prologue. The Wa are among the most vilified people in Asia, if not the world. This has been true for ages. To the Imperial British, they were filthy and undoubtedly savage. Before that, China's Qing dynasty deemed them the most obstinate among the barbarians. Even Vasco da Gama slandered the Wa, though the 16th century explorer never reached their homeland, a jagged stretch of mountains dividing Burma and China. He only heard rumors about the tribe, which he immortalized in a poem. On human flesh, with brutal hunger, they feed, and with hot irons stamp their own rude deed. He was wrong. The Wa weren't cannibals. They were headhunters, ritually planting enemies' heads on spikes. Like Scottish clans and French revolutionaries, they had their reasons. From the Middle Ages to the 21st century, the Wa have been steadily denigrated. They quit headhunting a few generations ago. The last skulls were lopped off sometime between Beatlemania and disco. But the stigma endures. They're now branded as a narco tribe. Practically everything written about the Wa portrays them as vicious hill people who churn out illegal drugs. few cultures are so strongly linked to a commodity. The Amish build furniture. The Swiss make watches. The Wa cook meth. And before meth was in vogue, the Wa churned out heroin. Their soil is cold and bitter. Terrible for vegetables, but ideal for heroin's raw ingredient. Papaver somniferum, the opium poppy. Like mountain peoples from Chechnya to the Ozarks, the Wa like to do things their own way. A tribal authority called the United Wa State Army, the UWSA, controls their native terrain, even though every inch technically sits inside Myanmar, also known as Burma. The UWSA makes laws, defends its motherland, builds roads, and collects taxes. It even issues driver's licenses. In every sense, it is a government. Yet to the United States of America, the latest empire to target the Wa, the UWSA is just a cabal of kingpins and drug lords presiding over a dangerous criminal syndicate. Dangerous to whom? Americans, we're told. That may surprise the Americans who've never heard of the Wa people, which is practically all of them. Still, the Drug Enforcement Administration insists that the Wa foster crime, violence, and terrible social damage here in the U.S. Illegal drugs are indeed one of the UWSA's top revenue sources. Over the years, tons of narcotics produced on Wa soil have hit the black market, and traffickers have smuggled them onto American shores. The DEA therefore sees the UWSA as a mastodon-sized trophy kill. America's stated goal is to disrupt and dismantle the entire system of Wa governance. Herein lies the problem. The UWSA isn't some jungle-dwelling mafia. It's running an honest-to-God nation called Wa State, home to more than 500,000 people. It has its own schools, electricity grid, anthems, and flags. Because it is not sanctified by the United Nations, its territory isn't marked on official maps, but it comprises more than 12,000 square miles. Wa State controls nearly as much soil as the Netherlands. Wa State's army commands 30,000 troops and 20,000 reservists, more than the militaries of Sweden or Kenya. The Wa possess high-tech weaponry, artillery, drones, and missiles that can knock jets out of the sky. When it comes to firepower, the UWSA makes Mexican cartels look like street gangs. The Wa stockpile guns for a reason. America isn't the only country they've had to worry about. Wa people are indigenous to China's frontier, just like Tibetans and Uyghurs, minorities who've suffered deeply under a Chinese government that micromanages their every move. The Wa have faced the same threat. So why is there a Free Tibet movement, but none to free the Wa? Because they freed themselves. Yet through Western eyes, they did it the wrong way, by producing illegal drugs, spending the profits on weapons, and daring outsiders to come take their land. There's no getting around it. Just as Haiti was built on sugar and Saudi Arabia on oil, Wa State was built on heroin and methamphetamine. The UWSA sits at the core of a Southeast Asian drug trade generating $60 billion each year in meth alone. The national economies of most real countries are smaller than that. Wa leaders are indeed sovereigns of a narco-state. But to capture them and toss them into American prisons would wipe out the executive branch of a foreign government. In other words, it would constitute regime change. This book is based on a modest conviction. When a superpower tries to undermine an entire civilization and doom its people as untouchables on the world stage, it is essential to seek out the underdog side of the story. That's what I've spent years trying to do. I'm an American journalist who has lived and worked in Bangkok for more than 15 years. In my day job with The World, a foreign affairs show airing on national public radio stations, I might cover anything from pop groups to riots. But I'm also a part-time narco-periodista, a reporter specializing in drugs and organized crime. The premise of my first book, Hello Shadowlands, is that lawbreakers tend to be rational actors, not just black-hearted ghouls. It's a collection of real-life stories about smugglers and rebels in Southeast Asia. You might suppose it would offer the UWSA more than a cameo, but that was all I could muster. Like Vasco da Gama, I'd only encountered the Wa through secondhand tales. I've been fascinated with Wa State, a forbidden republic hiding in plain sight, since the moment I learned of its existence. Growing up in a factory town in the Appalachian foothills, I have a soft spot for mountain peoples and always assumed the Wa couldn't be as sinister as their reputation. But it is hard, no, really damn hard, to get to Wa State. Vastly more difficult than traveling to North Korea or Antarctica. Americans face the highest bar to entry because the UWSA regards all U.S. citizens as potential spies. Harder still is sitting down with UWSA leaders, many of whom are wanted by the DEA. Still, I set out to meet the supposed supervillains of Asia's drug trade and understand their worldview. This book is the result. It is the saga of an indigenous people who've tapped the power of narcotics to create a nation where there was none before. But much more is at stake here than the struggle of a little-known tribal group. Hollywood and cable news would have us think the war on drugs is a conflict solely waged in the Americas. They've wrung dry every last detail about Latin kingpins. Meanwhile, Asia's underworld goes ignored. It is treated as a fringe curiosity that has little to do with the United States. That is a dangerous lie. When I began peering into the UWSA's inner workings, I didn't expect to find puppies and marshmallows. But what I uncovered was far stranger than I ever imagined. As it turns out, the origin story of this narco army is smudged with American fingerprints. Not only did the Central Intelligence Agency create the conditions for its inception, but one of its foremost leaders was also a DEA asset. The American government tells us the UWSA is a monster, poisoning our society for profit. But this is a beast that US agents, through malice and incompetence, have secretly nurtured. Every empire needs its barbarians. Superstar. They called him Superstar. His former Drug Enforcement Administration handlers still speak of him with reverence, which is unusual because confidential informants are seldom praised by anyone. CIs rat out fellow criminals to spare themselves from prison.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.